What we asked to have the opportunity to do was to have an informal opportunity to share with you a little bit about what our list looks like as we start to look at capital projects. And what we put in front of you, we know if you go down that list, certainly if you put dollar figures and add it up, it comes up to a lot more than what our annual capital budget is. But this is starting to put a list together of what some needs are. And we really felt like if we could have an opportunity to talk with you all to get a sense of what priorities look like from the commissioner's standpoint, and then really have some conversations in particular about the topic of our EdTech Center. We've had some discussion on that in years past, and we felt like rather than coming to you all with a budget request of items that we know are going to be an issue or there's some things that need to be resolved ahead of time, we'd like to do that. But wanted to have an opportunity just to have some conversation about what you all have concerns about or issues and priorities, or to help us have some direction as we forge our list and put it together. Again, this is not our capital request, so this is our beginning process of doing it.
And you asked us last year when we talked about budget to kind of put them in not by school but by priority things. And so we've got them in these groups based on what the need is, and we're trying to put them in priority now. And so that's why we thought it would be better to get your input to start with rather than come up with a capital budget and then come to you and you say, no, that's not a priority. So we thought like it would be better to get your input at this time.
Did you want to, somebody want to go over the list and review, or do you just want us to look at the list and comment? What's the path you want us to follow for this meeting?
Can we discuss EdTech and the items that are associated?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And there's, it may be that we need to spend some time in tech commissioners out to the building to see what we've got there. And I know one of the conversations in the short term that I've been here has been about the use of that building and then abandoning the building and then coming back to the building. And the fact that what we're doing there is a much smaller scope than a regular middle school. There are a number of issues that are on the page. If we're looking at using that building for, you know, 5-10 years down the road, there's some things that are going to have to be done to that. But we need to know what level of commitment we have before we start to make those decisions.
Okay.
Now, you may recall the hurricane damage that was sustained on that building did a lot of the capital work that was on our list that needed to be done, the roof repair on the educational building where the students are housed. We got the new floors down. We had wiring that was up. We had to go back with what we had. We didn't increase the capacity of the wiring through insurance, so we were able to get what's current now. We had really old wiring that's been updated and replaced. We had fresh paint put on the wall. The building looks nice, but there's some things that need to be done to it in terms of being able to use it for 4, 5, 10 years down the road. Patrick has a list of some other maps and floor plans pieces that I think will be beneficial for you all to see that as well.
Thank you. Dr. Phipps, what is the school system's intent towards the building, the Board of Education?
We're currently using it to house a Pathways program and the alternative school. We use that campus a lot for professional development. There are several parts of the building that are not used by students but are used by adults, and we would continue to use it that way. And I would like to see some more professional use down the road with the possibility of having some joint agreements with the community college to do some things on that campus, if we've got the ability to do that. But that's going to take planning and looking long-term at what will be needed to be able to pull that off.
Was your intent to maintain the entire structure or just portion of it?
Well, right now we're not using a wing that runs along, what's the name of the street?
Bridge Street.
Bridge Street. down toward the Boys and Girls Club. We don't house any students in the classrooms in those six or eight rooms that are along that area. What we're talking about doing is to try to get away from the use of the boiler, if we can possibly do that, the expense that's associated with that, and to look at barred units or something like that feeding the school, which, but to do that, we're going to have an electrical upgrade. But we don't want to continue to rely long-term on the boiler, not knowing what we're going to get out of that, knowing the expenses involved with that. And also some window replacement, and just items like that that you'll see on the list.
Does any commissioners have any questions? Hood, do you have any questions concerning it?
I went over this at the last meeting, a little bit.
Well, you know, here's the problem with this. That school, when we were going through the famous $40 million, 2,000 surplus seat upgrades that are in the school system now, that school was held up as the example of the one school in Beaufort County that should be condemned, demolished, and never used again. Okay. We had some real fierce arguments over this because there was nothing wrong with the school except the dirt has accumulated around the building. If you go in there and do some landscaping, which was my proposal then, the school really didn't need that much of anything else. And I personally am going to have a problem supporting spending any capital money at this location simply because you've got 2,000 surplus seats in the school system. I really think you should take a look at how you're using the rest of the system, and you should abandon this site because you've condemned it once and abandoned it. And here we are sitting in here again talking about taking this building that the school system condemned and spending more money on it. And these rat holes, these things get to be real rat holes on these old buildings.
We did not make those decisions with the exception of one member. This is a totally different board. Most of that facility has been demolished. There's only a piece of it remaining. And the piece of it that's remaining now has a new roof on it, thanks to the hurricane. And it's a wonderful location for what we're using it for. We're using it for alternative school. It's a centralized location. All the high schools can send and middle schools can send their students there. It's also a wonderful facility for professional development. We don't have the money to send teachers away for professional development anymore. We're saving money by doing it in-house. And we're using a piece of this facility for that. So it has some very practical purposes. We're trying to make sound decisions and decisions that are best for the way the school system is and the children that are being served there. The 2,000 seats that I keep hearing referred to, I have yet to see that. I know there is some room at Southside High School, but an alternative school, the purpose of it, one of the purposes is that it's isolation to themselves, to have real concise study. And that's what they're doing now, the alternative school. And to have it moved into Southside kind of defeats the purpose of having an alternative school.
I have a question about this location. One of the things we've talked about over the years, or I've talked about, and I think you guys are starting to talk about it now, at least on a state level, and I think locally as well. We need to have more vocational ed in schools, and these children that do not fit in to the going to college mode, and that could be why some of them are acting out. Maybe not, but it is a good idea to keep the vocational ed probably closest to them. Is there any ideas to take some of that structure, and I used to go to school there, so I'm very familiar with it, and it would work well for this, turning a large part of it into vocational ed.
Well, I think that was what Dr. Kutsey's just referring to.
And our long-term use would to do that and to partner with the community college so that we'd be able to benefit both bodies. You know, our feel is that we have the K-12 responsibility for students, and there are some students who are going to elect not to go to college or to university, and there's some vocational opportunities we want to make sure that we're making available to them, and we felt like that was a central location that would benefit us. The power and the power supply, that school is the major concern that we've got. Those rooms along the street, down Bridge Street, would be great. But that's part of the long-term plan that we'd like to come back to you all with. I'll tell you, to be honest with you, the biggest thing that we need to make that happen in our county is funding for a midday bus run. And if we have the ability to run a midday bus either to that location or to community college, we'd be able to afford students the opportunity at some of those vocational programs that we can't afford to put in our schools. But we really shouldn't do that when we've already got a community college that's offering those. The barrier right now for students is the transportation piece. But as I've talked to Dr. Tansey, and we're looking at some of our long-term plans and what programs we'd like to consider, that certainly would be one of the options rather than building a new school somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
Try to do that.
Or retrofitting what you already have.
But it would be limited. We could do everything we wanted to do. But we've got a lot of land in that area. If we wanted to do a greenhouse, if we wanted to do something for some type of major construction industry type thing, something like that.
I, too, was a commissioner along with Hood at that time when the argument was this was a terrible location, bad neighborhood, blah, blah, blah. And it is a wonderful piece of land. It's probably 15 acres, 16 acres, something like that. And am I close? And it's a centrally located. It's really perfect. I was always in favor of keeping that school going. But then again, I was in favor of keeping the old high school going, too. But
So what you're saying, Dr. Phipps, is the future plan would be to use it for an alternative school and also for technical slash craft training?
Yes. And we can continue to do professional development on portions of the campus that we're doing right now.
How would this affect the craft programs you presently have at Southside, Northside, and Washington High School?
We're including the faculty from all three of our high schools on the planning board. We met for the first time on Friday with the community college, trying to work out some seamless transitions and where the holes are in terms of the needs for programs that we have. The existing programs that are in place would certainly work, and it may be that we can have folks come out to the school to work with the students that are at EdTech, the students that are at risk, and that we're trying to give them another option beyond the high school diploma one. But we're really in the planning stages for all of that now.
Chairman is now here. Would you keep the craft training that you already have, the masonry and the carpentry and the welding, would you keep them at the schools you presently have them?
We're looking at all those to determine what we need to keep and what we need to look at expanding or if there's something that we need to get rid of. And part of that would be keeping at the schools that they're at. Some others may be more growth and development in the areas. Auto mechanics is an example. We had a program at Northside High School when we lost our instructor, looking at trying to refill that position again with old antiquated equipment, not benefiting our students. The community college has a nice auto mechanics program, and they've invited us to be able to participate and work with them in the afternoon hour, but we have no way of getting students over there. So we're looking at those types of options, and we don't want to duplicate services. But we want to make sure that what we're offering and what we're committed to for a 10-year time period, we're doing the best we can with what we have.
Okay. I ask you this question, then I'll shut up. But did you want to go, Commissioner?
Go ahead.
Let me ask this question real quick. What would you do if you did not have the EdTech Center? What kind of plan would you put in place?
We'd have to have another location to serve the students for the alternative high school and middle school. We serve students 6th grade through 12th grade, and we'd have to be able to manage the Pathways program at another location.
It couldn't be consolidated, possibly?
The two were separate. Depend on space and where we try to pull that off.
Okay. Commissioner Booth, it's your meeting now.
Mr. Chair.
Go right ahead.
Thank you. Well, I would love to support the effort to keep the EdTech Center. I don't know how many years it's been since I missed the graduation from EdTech. Yes, Washington High School students, bad, Southside, they're supposed to be all right. When you see kids that have fallen by the wayside and make it, and some of the things that y'all have done, that's, to me, that's the best money that we have spent. Yes, if I got a full-time scholarship, I'm supposed to go to Carolina, Duke, or Yale. But how about the kid that fell out of school and get the opportunity to go to Beaufort Community College? And on the other term is, even if you go with your vocational programs that you and Dr. Tansley has talked about, if we can have buildings or building they're ready for, there's also grants out there that will support your cause. General Motors. If you were in a mechanic, they got money for you and other people. But I would hate to see that building destroyed. It's not a bad building. Even Hood admitted that it wasn't a bad building when they was trying to get the bond. And since the storm, it's even better than it was when it was trying to get the bond.
If I can add, there's some things we don't do. We don't operate the cafeteria, the functional cafeteria. It's a satellite cafeteria where meals are brought over to students. And there is a limit in terms of the number of students that we can serve there for those reasons. The media center, which is a standalone building, is used for professional development now. So there are some limitations in terms of the future possibilities in terms of overall numbers of students. And we'd have to keep that in mind. And if, as we talk about vocational, that's one component of the big picture. The things at the community college, the things that they're doing and they're doing well, the things that they're involved in, again, we're not trying to duplicate those services. We want to be partners with them so that we're helping each other out. And if there's some services that we can build at that location or another one of our locations that the community college can partner with us and benefit from that, we certainly want to do that rather than having two folks doing the same thing at two different locations. We know that we've got a dollar to spend and we can only spend it one time. And I want to spend it the way I would spend my own, and I certainly respect the taxpayers and understanding what their demands are. We want to try to go through a transparent and fiscally responsible process of not going after a money grab, be reasonable and rational in the decisions that we're making, and trying to put good items on this list as we move forward.
If the state of North Carolina is going to revamp education, I think that's going to happen, especially with the people they got in Raleigh right now. You're going to see more and more dollars going to vocational education as an alternative. The whole college thing was a bad idea. Everybody has to go to college. That was a really terrible idea. It's like everybody's supposed to own a house. It didn't work, and it's not going to work. Everybody do not have the same intellect, and quite frankly, they should. Everybody's different. We need people from all walks of life, and all work is honorable. And there's not one job better than another job, in my opinion. So we're going to be moving this direction, I hope, I pray, if we can keep the sanity in Raleigh going for a while longer. So there'll be some money available coming out of Raleigh. They'll probably take it from somewhere else and give it to this project. I don't think there's going to be a whole lot of more money going into education in North Carolina. Just like there might not be a whole lot more money going into education from this county. But we will take from one sector to give to another sector. And I think this is the direction we should go in. We need more plumbers. We need more sheetrock people. We need more master carpenters. We need more electricians. We need more welders. And there are some things you can do. I know at the community college, they do a lot of electrical work, a lot of welding, stuff like that. It would be good to just get back to shop, having shop. And teaching them people how to drywall, how to fix something, and understanding that there is a certain logic towards making something work that was not working. You don't have to go out and get something new. Make it work. And some kids are probably, you'll find, that are more on a path towards college may want to take shop classes because it's fun and they're learning something they're not getting at home or somewhere else. So it could be great for everyone.
And our emphasis has been to look at those students that may be college-bound as well and encourage them, yes, to participate in what we call CTE, our Career and Technical Education Program, because there are classes there that I feel like would build the capacities of those students. And I agree with you. I don't want to value a college-going student versus a non-college-going student. We want to make sure that whatever a student wants to do post-high school career, we've got them prepared and ready to do that. And you're going to see that we're working hard on financial literacy, some of those basic skills the students have. We love for them, if they're going to be a drywall person, to own their own business, or if they're going to be a plumber or a cosmetologist or whatever they choose to be, to make them financially understand how you incorporate and what the tax laws are and where you get permits and those types of things. So going back to the basics, not just of the craft and trade itself, but all the other big pieces that follow that. And we want all of our students to have that experience. If they're going to be a surgeon, we want them to know the same types of things. So there really shouldn't be limits on those basic skills that all of our students should have.
Certain genius lying in all of us, or most of us, and we just got to find it.
Chairman, I think we have to also remember what the type of student you're dealing with in this situation is all of the vocational courses are fine, and I'll speak to that, but you, a lot of these students need basic, basic skills before they can approach doing vocational work. They have slipped through the cracks, as Ed said, and they don't have the reading and math skills when they enter probably the Ed Tech Center to do vocational work. So that's another thing that you've got to emphasize at an alternative school or a Pathways. These students are functioning at a level where we have to pull them up in order for them to get to vocational education. The second thing is I think we don't need to think of vocational education necessarily in the old sense of the word that we have masons and carpenters. There are a lot of vocations out there now that have nothing much to do with using large motor skills. They're fine motor skills like repairing computers and things like that, or that is a vocational type thing that wouldn't require you to go to college, but will require some higher intellectual abilities.
Yeah.
So we need to think too in terms of being able to even send children into the medical profession to repair machines in hospitals. Things like that are just as important as learning, and probably pay a whole lot more.
Yeah, but there's going to be only so much need for repairing of machinery and computers, and there's going to be a greater need for people to fix things, to build things. Food, shelter, and clothing. That's what I always look at. And we're going to need that well over computers. You're talking to a guy that sits behind a computer 10, 12 hours a day, and I think, you know, how much do I need to fix my computer? I just go buy another one. Equipment, large equipment's a different story. Supercomputers, that's a different story. But these guys, they're going to fix this stuff. They're going to come out of North Carolina State or someplace where they've probably got a degree in that. It's going to take that, possibly, for that kind of thing. You're dealing with some pretty intricate stuff, or you just take it out and replace it and get a monkey to do that. We gotta have people that can fix stuff, do drywall, fix plumbing. This kind of work is very, very important, and it's a very honorable profession. And through that, we will teach everyone that all work is honorable. It is important. All work is important. And some of this is even more important. Get your hands dirty. Use your muscles. Make you feel good.
Commissioner Clem.
Yes, could I ask some questions about this list? You have several different categories, but if I just look at Category B, is the highest priority item on the top? Are these in any sort of order?
Our board has not gone through and done a priority list yet. What will be under each category in terms of priority one all the way down to the bottom?
Okay, and the other thing would you be combining it priority-wise so you just have one priority list instead of by sections?
That's a tough decision for us. When you look at the S list, which is the safety
automatically goes to the top most places.
Everything within safety, priority-wise, is that more important than anything else on the list? And that's what we've got to make a decision about. Certainly, safety is an area of concern and issue. There are a variety of issues that are listed, but we try to be careful too. As we put that list together, there are three items that fall under the S category. There could be 50 items there. There's a variety of different things that we'd be putting together, but we tried to parse the list down to some degree. It could be much bigger than what you have here, but the overall priority numbers are going to be a combination of the category itself and then what the priority is within the category.
Uh-huh.
But we've not had an opportunity as a group yet to determine what the exact order will be.
Say safety is normally the highest priority, but it's normally assigned by risk.
Yes,
that which needs to be addressed immediately and that which can be scheduled and that which can be phased in.
So there are bills being discussed in the General Assembly in the state right now that may provide some funding in the security and safety area. We're not sure how that money is going to flow down and to what extent we're going to have what we need.
Thank you.
Any other questions? I just have one. What did I miss? The whole conversation about the Ed Tech Center, I came in on the tail end, so I'm in the dark.
Thank you.
See, Stan beat me here. By a lot.
Chairman, what we wanted to do today was to have an opportunity to have a dialogue and conversation without presenting a budget with, you know, values with it or anything like that at this point, to get a sense of what you all value as priorities, to give us some idea and framework that we can go back and start to put together our request list that we'll come back to you later this month with. And one of the topics was the ed tech center in terms of the overall feeling of the commissioners in terms of the future use of that building. And is that something that we can continue to look at? Or are we going to absolutely not get any support for the ed tech center? And if we know that, then we use that in terms of how we develop our leaders.
And so basically what I heard was each commissioner giving their thoughts about the ed tech. Okay.
I got another question.
Okay.
I'd like to see what your vision is for the ed tech center, what it would take it to get to what your vision is, and define it by line item. That would give us an overall cost of what's involved with the ed tech center and what the future of the ed tech center would be.
And our goal for that, not just at the ed tech center, we're, as we do the ORED study, the results of that come back, the population study pieces that go along with it,
yes,
the work that Jimmy Hite did recently. We want to roll all of that into a long-term plan, and that would include the ed tech center and all the other long-term capital needs that we're going to have in the years to come, but we certainly can do that.
Thank you.
Okay. Your next item.
Let's. I guess we wanted just to make you aware of how difficult it is to maintain 13 schools, as many buildings as we have, with the amount of capital funds that we're getting. And there are some classroom additions that need to be done, multi-purpose or any other Eastern Elementary classroom space over at the Chaco and the primary. Those things are coming up, and we're pushing them back, and we can't even keep up with the maintenance needs on the buildings that we have. And so you can imagine, I'm sure you can, the amount of frustration it is to decide. It's like sitting at a table with 500 children deciding which one you're not going to feed when we go to sit down and try to do the capital. So that's why we thought coming to you first and saying, what do you see that are important needs, rather than us trying to decide what we think is important and coming to you and saying there's no money for that. So we thought this would be a more advantageous way to do it.
And just a second, because the way I look at this, and I take this and look through it, obviously, like Mr. Fink was saying, I agree with, and I think everybody agrees, safety issues, energy conservation issues, it's going to put money into something that's going to save us some money.
Mm-hmm.
If you were to go through here and put dollar amounts, there's probably $700,000 to $800,000 on this list that would pertain just to that alone. Now, when I look at this list, I also know that immediately this is not probably a one-year program. This is something that several of these items here are going to be put on what, well, I would call the back burner. I think someone already mentioned that earlier, for another year. So knowing things from the commissioners, such as the ed tech discussion, what would be completely off the table allows us to go back and not put dollar amounts, you know, to those items, so we can come back to you with a really good, hopefully a good idea of what we need now. But, you know, it's very difficult for us when we look at those and we know that, yes, safety needs to be addressed right away. In issues of, you know, replacing a window that at one of our schools is welded, basically welded open, not welded shut, because they're older school, we can't close them and you got gaps. You know, just replacing things like that is going to mean a big difference in getting our energy costs down. We're all well aware that we need to continue to work to get our energy costs down. But it takes money sometimes to do that. And then knowing that we have issues that, you know, safety-related issues like some of our schools, just the pickup of our children, having to reroute systems that we know we can't afford to do because of the money. And we're well aware. We're taxpayers. We understand, believe it or not. It may not seem like something, but we do understand. So knowing from you if there's something on the list that just, you know, that's just out of the question, then we don't have to worry about putting dollar amounts to it. We'll move in the direction that you'd be willing for us to work together with you guys. Because that's really all we want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Work with you in the same direction. Whatever you think's a good way to go, that's kind of the way we'd like to present back to you guys. But, you know, when you talk about safety issues, you can rack up a lot of money real quick just covering that.
Mr.
We, Thank you. We not, I mean, I would think that safety is a grave concern to all of us. And I appreciate what you're doing now, but with priority. But I've been hearing this about windows and doors ever since I've been a commissioner. We've done some other things that weren't necessary, and we could have fixed those windows and doors. And as long as you're spending the money wisely, a priority list and not a wish list, I don't have no problem at all with supporting.
And I'm quite sure that's true.
I know it's true.
Because in the 3 years that I've been on the
board, I know it's true.
The 3 years that I've been on the board, we've talked about the same thing.
Yeah.
But when you get handed down to you this much money, and the needs are beyond that amount of money, the sometimes some of the windows and some of the doors move to another year.
That's what happens
because
with
issues make that, more important, more greater.
That's what happens when you got a wish list and not a priority list.
That is correct.
I'm used to, excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
I'm used to seeing long-term capital plans. Depends on the company. Sometimes it can be a three-year plan. They lay out the three-year, and it can go 5 years. I've seen them go as long as 10 years, but the one thing you normally see is they do a plan for a specific period of time, and then each year they come back and they upgrade the plan. But normally at the end of the plan, be it 5 years or whatever, there's some sort of goal of what they really want to accomplish in relation to the plan. And it'd be good if the school somehow could put together some sort of, say, a five-year plan or something of some term that defines the things that would need to be done now and go through the 5 years. And with all the things listed, see where we are and whether that even gets us to where we need to be. You understand what I'm saying?
And I think that's actually where we kind of headed.
That's where you headed,
yeah. We know that this list that we have come up with, this can't possibly be a one-year list. So we're looking at trying to give you items so that it won't be sort of like, you know, a surprise every year. You'll see the things that you would agree to work with us on funding for next year, and the things that are on this list, you would know that they're coming back to you with that. So that's your second year, you know. The only thing that would be is, if you want to call it, I would call it a surprise, but just knowledge, is the list keeps getting repopulated. Because by next year, some new things that we don't even know about today are going to pop up and surface and have to be added back to this. But absolutely what you're saying is what I would like to see the board, and I'm just speaking for myself, I'd like to see us come to you with a plan that's going to be 2 or 3, 4, 5 years, and you know that these items are going to come back to you until eventually we can fund them. Knowing that this is the
opportunity,
this.
What kind of a timetable did you come here with for these items that you wanted us to give a response to? I mean, and the reason I asked that is because you said you wanted to prioritize them, and so what kind of timetable have you set for yourselves?
We need to have our work wrapped up by the end of the month of April.
Yeah.
Oh, we'll.
Sir.
So you will?
Yes. We normally try to do it by the end of the year.
We would have to have it by the end
of the year. You have various categories. Excuse me. I'm sorry. You got various categories of things you do. You got capital. You got your repair, your breakdowns, that kind of stuff. And you got your preventive maintenance. And obviously, if you don't, you don't do your preventive, your anticipative, and in some cases a large thing, you might do some predictive maintenance. If you don't do that, well, that adds to the capital, and that adds to the other area. And as you're saying, as you go forward, you continue to add stuff, we need to be aware that we need to do something with the maintenance area in respect to stop items from moving from that area to the capital area. We got to do better with what we're doing somehow.
Mr. Chairman.
I don't see why you can't take your dream for the future of the Ed Tech Center and do that as one separate item, because it is a separate item, and give us the same thing that you've been giving us for the rest of your items. And then we can decide what together we need to be doing. But the Ed Tech Center is definitely a separate item. You can't commingle it with the rest of that stuff, because that requires an individual decision.
I agree with that.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask? Oh, did you replace the windows at Eastern Elementary this year? They're done. So that's all.
They might.
That's all. Oh, that's really good. But you know, Mr. Chairman, that the whole time I was on the Board of Education, it seemed like every year you'd put out a capital outlay plan that you thought you could do, and then something would come along, a hurricane would come along and blow the roof off of the gym at Bath. So you had to reroute, you know, $200,000 or $300,000 somewhere else, and it just kind of destroys your every year something like. For instance, now if the chiller at Washington High School, if it could not be repaired and went down, that would just take this whole capital outlay list that they got here and just throw it into awry, because they got to replace that chiller, you know, and if a roof blows off a building or and insurance doesn't pay it all, then they got to replace that roof. I mean, there's always something that comes up, like Northeast, the drainage. We did a whole budget down there that year, didn't have the drainage in it, and then the architect comes along and says, if you don't do something about this drainage, your foundation to your school's going to give way. And so all of a sudden we're having to spend, what was it, $120,000, $130,000 on drainage.
Maybe about $180,000.
A lot of money.
That we didn't know we were going to have to spend. So it seems like every you take one step forward and two back on stuff like this, because there's always something unanticipated coming along.
That's what I was saying, Mr. Belcher, in reference to prioritizing. That drainage problem didn't happen overnight.
We didn't know. I mean, but I didn't know about it.
It really didn't happen overnight. I mean, it didn't happen. I've been hearing about the chiller ever since I've been a commission at Washington High School. It didn't happen yesterday. So those are the kind of things that you had to prioritize.
But, Mr. Chairman.
As a new board member, what I would ask of all of you is not to dismiss anything that you haven't seen. When I did the tour, and I went in every single school as a new board member, so I could familiarize, most of them I've been in, but I familiarized myself with some of these things as Mr. Obelai conducted the tour, but there is nothing that compares to seeing some. I'm reading some of this, and if you're reading it cold, yeah, okay, replace this. But I saw it, and it looked terrible, you know. So what I'm saying is, don't dismiss things just because we haven't given you the priority. You've also got time as a commissioner to talk with Dr. Phipps or Mr. Obelai and say, I'd like to see this. I'd like to see this before we make a decision on it, because nothing compares to looking at it. Just like one of the discussions I had with Mr. Belcher before we he passed it on to me was about the lack of a multi-purpose room at Eastern Elementary. I have a daughter that teaches there. I know what's going on inside that building. I've been in it hundreds of times. Yet when I went in there as a board member and I saw the kids were taking PE in a trailer in a room that if any two of you men, not to say you're heavy, but if any
yes,
two
you are.
If you jumped up and down in the middle of that room, you would go through the floor. And that's where these kids are having PE, because they don't have a multi-purpose room.
How long have they been having PE in that multi-purpose room?
They have moved PE all over that school for years because there isn't a multi-purpose room. But now that school's busting at the seams. So they've got more kids than they've got classrooms. They've got classrooms that used to be custodian closets. I mean, it's
so,
really...
So we've been needing the multi-purpose room.
They've been keeps, okay. From what I've been told from Mr. Belcher and other boardmen, every year they move it down because it's $600,000. So it keeps moving down, but at some point, that needs to be a priority.
That may be even an item that we have to discuss with you to set aside. You know, whether it's, I'm going to figure out, that nobody's discussed but me, $100,000 a year. Till we build up enough money to build that.
Well, some of them children will be graduating.
Well, that's true. Because we've been in the middle of spending $600,000. Right, as Mr. Dorff was saying when hurricanes come up. If we just said, well, this year we'll spend $600,000, well, let's say last year, because I know what last year's budget was. There was no way we could spend $600,000 because that just wrecked our entire capital budget. Yep. Then there would be nothing to do. And as Mr. Klein was saying, we have to have money somewhere within our system to do maintenance so that we don't have an item end up on capital. So it's a real hard judgment act sometimes. But you never can just take 1 year and take $600,000 out of it. And I believe me, I know about those chillers. I've been down in that I call it the dungeon, where they sit at and look at, and, you know, every time the phone rings and I see it says central office, I'm like,
chill.
This isn't, call this is a chiller.
Chill.
But eventually it'll happen because they're 23 years old.
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
Have the new school board members had opportunity, or do you have a copy of the capacity study that was done, that the county commissioners commissioned to have done? Do you have a copy?
In the beginning, before I was actually on board, I think it was in, while Robert was still on the board, but it was in the month of December, this when they went through all of that. Now, I sat in on it, but I wasn't officially a member at the time.
Well, I would like for every school board member to have their own copy of that capacity study, because the 2,000 seats that we keep talking about, there's actually more capacity there than the 2,000 seats. So that was done rigorously according to the maximum or minimum standards, depending on your viewpoint. And frankly, I'm going to have a problem supporting building any new classrooms when you can change school districts and move children to where they're supposed to be. I don't think the taxpayers should be building more floor space when the capacity is there within the system. And that's what you need to be thinking about doing. And I realize when I say that, that is a hot political issue. But the taxpayers are going to have to decide whether they want to be taxed more or whether they want to use these empty rooms. And I, as a commissioner, am going to be voting to use the empty rooms.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
I guess I want to speak positively, but first I want to speak negatively.
That's canceled.
We were talking about the drainage out at Northeast. I mean, who would have known that? Well, Hood Richardson and I were screaming almost that that school should not be built in a place called Hell Swamp. I mean, we made a big deal out of it. And at that time, you guys had a very weak school board. And we had a very weak board of county commissioners. A lot of things got done at that time that were just plain stupid. Now, I think we've got a stronger board of commissioners, believe it or not, and I think you guys have a much stronger school board. As long as we can get together and talk through things and make decisions that are more prone to planning, where we can look forward, plan years in advance, maybe to speaking to Hood, there'll be some money coming from the state for vocational education, because I think that's where the state's going to be heading more and more. I mean, I'm seeing it. The stuff I put up on Beaufort County now, more state money is going to vocational education. And we'll probably see it in this General Assembly. I hope we will. So if we can use what resources we have, push in a smarter direction, all get on the same boat and pull the oars at the same time, maybe we can make this thing work without killing the taxpayer. But there is going to be some borrowing from one school of thought to give to another. We just got to make sure we're on the same page with that same school of thought, so we never do something as stupid as build another school in a place called Hell Swamp.
Don't worry about it. You won't be building any schools during your lifetime. Not to worry about it.
Mr. Chairman,
go ahead.
It sounds to me, listening to y'all, one concern is that you'll have an item that just goes on there year after year after year, and it just doesn't get to the list because other things keep displacing it. And looking at the list in the past, most of the things that are on the list need to be done. I mean, it's not a case of, hey, let's skip this, but there got to be some sort of trigger or priority system that causes an item after a period of time, if it's irrelevant and it's an item that needs to be done, that would cause that item to move to the top of the list and get done no matter what, if it needs to be done. And again, that all has to do with what kind of plan you're going to develop, and I strongly encourage a longer-term plan along with what you do every year. What you give us every year is very good, I think.
Yeah.
But I'd like to see it stretched out, and I would like to see an item that gets on there and it vegetates. But we need to see that item vegetating, how long it's vegetating, and make some decision at some point of what we're going to do to an item like that. Because you can have stuff never get done. And if you look at most of the studies on some of this stuff and what it costs to have an unscheduled piece of equipment, an unscheduled maintenance event that results in a failure can compared to taking care of a problem, it can cost as much as 4.5 times in relation to what it might be. I'm not saying it has anything to do with this, but you're a whole lot better off planning and getting it out into the future at this point, I truly believe.
Anybody else have anything? Do you have something else for us?
Yes, sir. Our goal is to work together. The words have been spoken. We do want to work as two bodies that have the same vision, the same focus, and work with one another. And don't let egos get in the way. Don't let other things get in the way. We need to do this for the students, for the children in our county. We owe this as an obligation to them, and we should do right by them by being the adults and have rational minds on the things that we do. And I think planning and sharing, being open to ideas and having that dialogue and discussion is the way that we get there. And we appreciate your time very much.
Anything further from any commissioners? The school board?
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Please take a tour anytime you have time.
We did.
Yep.
Yeah.
I know you've done it.
Call me. I'll go with anybody you've done.
Okay. Well, we thank you for coming.
Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Yes, stitches.
Motion to adjourn.
Bleeding so hard. Bleed out.